Hi, I'm Christian from Replex. I will start with the first part. I will tell you something about my personal history of virtualization. The slides are in German. Sorry for that. I will start with my personal history of virtualization. Then how I collect data, how I visualize data in the past and now. How we store data and how we can aggregate data today, and what's the problem with the aggregation. In my first company we had I think 6 or 7 servers, one server, one application. We had a database server, a web server, a server for building, and that was. Virtualization was not in the mindset of any one of us. A few years later, we see the Linux vServer project, and played a little bit with that. It was really cool, but the problem was we have a kind of isolation, like change root, but non-real isolation. One process can see no other, but only himself, but it's one network for everything. It's the same RAM. We have no resource management for the only vServers. That was not really great, but it was the starting of all. A few years later, we started with paravirtualization and full virtualization with KVM, VMware, and Xen. And there are many other virtualization. there are many other solutions for virtualization, but we used the three. This was the first time we had some resource management and real isolation of the only processes and the only operating systems. Now we use the real modern IT stack with Docker, with Rocket, with Kubernetes, with Apache Mesos, Mesosphere, DCOS. Now we have many, many applications on one server or on one cluster or something else. The isolation is better. We have C groups, we have namespaces and all the other stuff. Orchestration with Mesosphere and Kubernetes. So, the metrics. Our main point, also the main point of our software, the first tool I used was Nmon. There are many single tools like PS or TOP or LSOF. You can see data from your service, from your operating system. With Nmon, that was the first tool for me. I can see more things than only one. Here I can see the CPU utilization, the disk I/O, memory, and something else. That was really cool. Nmon has another feature. Nmon has written Nmon files, Nmon log files, and there was some tools you can visualize and correlate this data together. That was for me the first time I saw such things. Now. We do this with this type of tools, CollectD, InfluxDB, or Grafana for on-premise systems, or with the newer toolset MetricBeats, Elasticsearch, and Kibana, or a cloud-native stack with cAdvisor and Prometheus as data store, and Grafana to visualize the data. Here is an example for a Grafana dashboard. Now with Grafana you have you can see every data, every matrix together, and CPU graph together with a network graph, together with what have running containers here for some time steps for the last 2 years, the last 2 minutes, or what was last week for a problem. I changed a company for a few years, and we had some racks. Here in this example, we have 4 racks, but we had no tool to visualize which server is in which position of the rack. So what was the first we have done? We used Excel. That was the not really good. We found a tool for such things. It was rack tables. We played a little bit with rack tables. But that was also not really cool. We had a puppet system for configuration management, and we tried to see which VM is on which host, and we tried to visualize this with rack tables, but it was not really good. which each Rectables update, everything was broken. So that's also not really cool. In the modern version, in the modern IT stacks, you have hybrid clouds. You have some applications by Azure, some applications by AWS, by Google, or something else. Part is on-premise with VMware or KVM. You have so much data stores for your performance counter, your performance measurements, your monitoring data. And the problem now is how you can aggregate all these data from all these data pools together in one view. So, with all these data stores, it's for an operator or for a DevOps, it's okay to have a look into the application or to debug the application. It's a kind of this. You have one data store, another data store, the next data store, the next data store. People like us can analyze and debug one thing with that. That's okay. But the businessman has no chance to aggregate this data in a cool way. So with our new software, with Replex, we had a kind of picture like this. We integrate everything, and you have one single view for everything. Yeah, at this point, Patrick will carry on.
All right, let me just make sure this is working. Yeah, okay, I'm going to try not to throw this off. I'm going to try and not throw off the audio again. So yeah, my name is Patrick. Thanks for having us. So my background is with Dynatrace. I don't know if anybody knows them in the APM application performance monitoring space. I think they changed the name to management now, but whatever. And yeah, since 2016, I've been with Replex. And I really want to carry on this kind of talk from my colleague Christian here and take it somewhat a little bit more high level at this point. And, you know, we've had this whole topic today about the modern IT infrastructure stack, talking about Kubernetes, talking about, you know, modern cloud setups with potential multi-cloud setups. And we have one big problem that's arisen in kind of the last 5 years, I'd say. German word, but complexities. Now, in the last, 5, 10 years, we've seen a steady rise of like a load of different technologies in the market. So let me actually show you what I mean. You know, traditionally, we all know something like this, right? Some physical infrastructure with some kind of virtualization layer on top. And that scale for large companies is already very hard to manage. And my colleague Christian actually touched on that with large data centers. People still do use Excel to count their servers, believe it or not. And that can take incredible amounts of time. We had cases where people would send 5 people out for 3 months, and by the time they came back, things were already completely different. Now, today, we kind of see layers like this. Now, before anyone points it out, I do realize that layer 5 and 6 are kind of the same one. It's just, you know, visual. It looks nice this way, basically. But yeah, my point being, though, is that we have an incredible amount of different types of technology that enterprises can use, and that enterprises and larger companies, but also smaller companies, can use at the same time. So you have these silo teams which decide to use specific technologies because they like it, they think it's cool, they think it's more efficient than another technology, and then another team thinks, well, I don't really want to use that, so they'll go off and use something different. So the bigger problem that we have here is on one side that different technologies in the different companies are being used, but then also, how do you get that global view back together? How do you then decide, well, okay, cool, maybe 1, 2 teams in itself are running efficiently, but on a global scale, on a company-wide scale, are we actually running efficiently? And something that completely baffles me every time I see this number, and sorry about the German title again, weirdly enough, the next one is English, but whatever. In the cloud alone, on a yearly basis, it's $54.7 billion being wasted on resources that are being provisioned but not used. Now, this is actually the number from 2016. The number from 2017 just came out. It's actually closer to $60 billion. That's actually 50% of all vCPUs that exist in the cloud today. Now, for me, that's mind-blowing. But before we go into kind of a specific scenario that I wanted to show you, you know, the reason why this exists in first place is, on one side, these complexities that I mentioned just now, but also just the way that organizational structures work today. And that starts with the development process and kind of pulls all the way through into production. And kind of to look at a specific scenario here, you know, in this scenario, we have kind of a complete AWS infrastructure. Didn't want to go into kind of a multi-cloud setup at this point, but that could be anything underneath at the end of the day. And this is kind of the before scenario where there are reserved instances and spot instances running on different five different applications. And just to make it more real, about 7 million yearly AWS costs. Of course, this could be anything. I just like to assign numbers to things to make it more visual for everyone. Now, in this case, actually, I wanted to talk about something that we've talked about quite a lot today, a Kubernetes migration in this case. So how do you get from this to a clustered setup, basically, with Kubernetes? And so in this case, what happened is that the complete microservice architecture was basically migrated with Docker as a container engine to a Kubernetes cluster in this case. And this brought along some very serious changes for companies. I don't know, has anyone gone through this process of going from kind of a traditional, it's weird to say, right, but traditional AWS infrastructure to Kubernetes on AWS in kind of, you know, any sense? Well, for developers, there's a very interesting cultural change when that comes along. Now, we've had this a lot with customers recently, and they struggle with it quite a bit, that developers suddenly become much more involved with the entire deployment. So the entire chain from development to production, you're suddenly responsible for making sure a container is not only efficient, but it's also stable in production later. Now, the goal of this scenario, of course, is to increase the density of your system to make sure the efficiency is better than just on a standard AWS microservice infrastructure, but also to increase the density, so also relating to the efficiency of the system. Now, putting a Kubernetes cluster on top of your AWS is great, for sure. I mean, there are, you know, 1,000 use cases that I can think of where it definitely makes sense to do. But there are some very distinct problems that you get with this. And this is mostly to do with this kind of new abstraction layer that you've created. And, you know, when we talk to kind of customers a lot, there's always a few questions that have come up. How do we know which part of my app, or our service in that case, runs on which instance? So how can I say that, you know, application A, for example, has, I don't know, 100 users a day, whatever. How do I know that doesn't use 40% of my AWS infrastructure, for example? Or how can I split my infrastructure costs, my actual AWS costs, back into my dev teams, for example? How can I make sure that my containers are running as efficiently as possible? I'm making sure that the reserved or the provisioned resources are close to the actual utilization of that container. And then at the end of the day, did all of this chaos actually make sense? Did we really save money at the end of the day? Taking everything into consideration, not just your bill at the end of the day on AWS, but also taking into consideration, you know, the efficiency of everyone involved in this entire chain. Now, I know we put Replex there, but this could be anyone really, but the way that we kind of solved and other solution providers do this as well is basically to connect up the metrics from the different layers again. So to look at AWS in itself, to then connect to the API server of the master node, but also really to have a look at the monitoring from Kubernetes, which in this case was Heapster, where we just connected directly to the InfluxDB. And the interesting thing about this really is that, and this is kind of the big point of this talk, is that metrics by themselves in siloed situations are not necessarily as valuable as they could be if you combine them. So making meaningful connections from individual metrics is really where you want to get to. And what that enables you then to do is not just to solve those problems that I said earlier, but to also do more detailed things, like, for example, get early signs of trouble in a pod, for example. So here you can see the relative resource distribution across this pod. If you have hotspots suddenly on a CPU of one specific container in that pod, that could indicate that you suddenly have some problems, because what you ideally want in a production environment, and dev sometimes different, but in the production environment, what you definitely want is more of a panned out, kind of nearly equal resource utilization of those containers. What you then also can determine, of course, is whether those containers that have been you know, provisioned at some point are actually being used as efficiently as possible. And that's all to do with, of course, the kind of provisioned resources compared to the actual utilization of those resources. And then, going back to kind of the cost analysis of things, at the end of the day, what you want to do is, even if you're a DevOps, if you're in dev, you still want to be able to enable everyone else in the company, and especially some of, you know, your colleagues who might not be as technical as you, to kind of understand the efficiency of this entire system. And most business people kind of only understand numbers, me included. So it really helps if everybody from kind of the developer layer all the way to up to the less technical guys can have a common understanding of what you're trying to achieve, and that everybody can kind of speak the same language. And this is kind of my last slide, and this is really just concluding the point that metrics by themselves are great, but being able to combine them in meaningful ways across different silos and across different layers is where you really get that value-added benefit that you really want for an organization in total. And with that, thanks a lot for listening. I think that actually was quite short, but thank you very much. And if you have any questions, fire them out.